good to be here. Now, the main prayer I pray is, God, let them people understand I'm not a theologian. Now, I believe in Bible schools, but God never would let me go to one. Even though four different times it was offered to pay my way through one. And I got all excited and was ready to go, and God said no. And the first time I was at Pisgah with a man, one of the founding fathers of the Assemblies of God, by the name of Ralph Riggs, offered to pay my way through a Bible school there in Southern California with the Assemblies of God. I got real excited, folks. Of course, when he'd done that, I wasn't 17 years old. But God said no. So I went and told Brother Ralph. God said no, Ralph. He said, then don't go. He said, you don't have to have a Bible school education. He says, all you need is the Holy Ghost. I said, yeah. A couple of years later, a lady by the name of Jean Darnell offered to pay my way through Life Bible School. That's the one Sister Amy McPherson founded. Jean Darnell took the place of Amy McPherson as pastor of Angela's Temple. Now, she didn't take over the Four Square Church. She just took over the pastorship of Angela's Temple. Then I was offered it again in Texas, really a year after. God said no. And then my church in El Reno, they offered to pay my way through Rhema, you know, up there in Broken Arrow. I really got excited. And God said no. I probably couldn't have answered most of the questions right anyhow, because I had to answer them the way I believe the Word of God said them. Most of them, they don't have it that way. They've got all the church articles of faith that you've got to agree with. And a lot of them, I don't. Now, guys, I was born in Chickasha, Oklahoma. My father was a half-breed Cherokee, and my mother was a quarter-breed. And I'm German, and I'm Irish, Swede, Choctaw, and I'm 1/32nd black. Now, William Seymour taught one doctrine that I really liked. Of course, it got me in a lot of trouble in Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, and especially the Houston, Texas area. He taught when you got born again, you became a new creature that never existed before. He said, now whatever color you were, you're still that color, but you are no longer that race. When you're born again, you become a new creature. You're now a member of the Christian race. We all have the same Father. Now, I don't believe anything is coincidental. I believe God's got it all planned out. When I look back over the decades, I sit and marvel, even now, of how God had it all planned out. Since I was 3 years old, I loved to listen to stories and I loved to tell them. That wasn't a coincidence. Now, my mother started dragging me to what we call healing evangelists when I was 3 years old in 1946. And that first man, she dragged me there. I didn't want to go. I'd rather be out on the farm with my horse and my dog and fishing and hunting and swimming. The man's name was William Branham. Then in 1947, an old boy not far from us, his name was Earl Roberts. Then in 1948, they had an explosion. And Mama thought I had to go see everyone she'd get me to. I found out later why. But At the age of 14 in 1957, we lost the farm. See, Daddy had a good-sized farm, about 840 acres of land. 40 acres of it went into corn every year. And he didn't sell it by the bushel. What he didn't have for what we call the replanting seed, and some of the cows and horses and fattening up hogs. Daddy processed his corn and he sold it in quart fruit jars in clear liquid. And he neglected to pay any taxes on it. And in 1957, they caught him. And he had to go be a guest of the state in a town of McAllister, Oklahoma. That's the state federal, that's the state penitentiary. Just for not paying taxes on his corn. We lost the farm, and man, I went berserk. I could not handle not being on that farm. So I went into rebellion. Well, I finally got kicked out of home. I was on the streets for quite a while there around Chickasha. I wasn't that old, guys. And back in the 50s, there wasn't that many homeless teenagers. But I slept in bar ditches, hay lofts, vacant houses. Well, I got hungry quite often, so I got some guys up and we got what we called a burglary ring going. Now, that's not a smart ideal, okay? Well, it's kind of dumb. But they were taking fingerprints and they're getting a lot of evidence up, and they realized that a lot of those prints were mine. And they knew I was kind of the little leader of those little expeditions. Now, there was a grandma and her grandson there in Chickasha that was from a place called Venice Beach. Most people know it as Muscle Beach, California. Well, the boy was a year older than me, he was 18, Teddy. He decided he wanted to go back to Venice because he liked to go play pool, and he wanted Chickasha to play, have the, you know, the house rules like they had in Venice. And Chickasha didn't like their little house rules. So he'd pop off. Now, Oklahoma's a friendly state. Really is friendly. But if you go there and start popping off, you don't want to do that too much because you could, someone will feed you one of those cue sticks. After Teddy ate the second one, he decided he wanted to go back to Venice. Of course, he left a big deposit in Oklahoma off his front teeth. But they wanted me to go with them. And no, I didn't want to leave Oklahoma. I liked Oklahoma. But I had an old friend come along. He said, "Tommy, the police just took me in and grilled me and let me know they had a warrant for your arrest. They know who's been breaking into those places, and they know you're the ringleader. They know if they arrest you, the rest of us will split up." He says, "If I were you, I would consider that invitation to go to California with these guys." This is a grandma. "Nope, didn't want to go." He says, "Well, could I give you some advice?" I says, "What?" He said, "It's either go to California with these people or you're going to go to prison." I thought a minute or two, I went out and I slept over it overnight. I'm thinking, and I finally decided that California would be better. So I went with them to California. God had it all planned. To Venice Beach. There a couple of weeks, and me and Teddy got the like of the same girl. We got into a fight over her. All you guys, listen to me. I won the fight. But Teddy got the girl. I was brokenhearted. Grandma kicked me out because she said I got too mean. I thought, oh, God, man. He was the one that started the stuff. But I wound up at Venice Beach, took my cowboy boots off. I was sitting on a bench facing Venice Boulevard. And I'm looking down there at the old apartment complex where I came from. Then two older ladies were coming out and coming up Venice Boulevard. I recognized one of them as the landlord. The other one, later on, I put her in my book. Her name was Sister Goldie. Both were what we called Azusa Street Saints. When they were young, they went through the Azusa Street Revival. No coincidence. God had it all planned out. Well, they were coming after me, and I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, they're coming here to testify to you, boy. And I knew what they were going to do. They wanted to, I mean, so I got in my con mood and decided to play along with them. Maybe they'd feed me or give me a little money to buy some food. Sure enough, they walked right up to me. One sat on one side and one the other. And Sister Goldie started talking to me. And I played along with her. When she wanted me to say the sinner's prayer, I said it. Now, I was not earnest about it. But guys, it was like a oven went off in me. And I started shaking and I started crying. And I looked down at Sister Goldie and I said, I'm a Christian. She said, I know. But see, I was stunned. God saved me. And I'm looking at her and they took me back down to the landlord's apartment and fed me some supper. But dinner is what they call it in California. And I found that out the hard way. I got invited to dinner and I showed up at noon. And they told me, Tommy, dinner's not until 6:30 this evening. I said, that sounds more like supper. They just said, kind of confused out there, you know. And I go on down there and Sister Goldie came over the next morning. She had called a man named Smith at a place called Pisgah. And they took in homeless people. Well, that's why Smith took me in, because I was homeless. Had no place to go. So I wound up there. But on that bus ride from Venice Beach to Highland Park, which is right next to Pasadena, and they're right up against the San Gabriel Mountains. Beautiful place up in there. But the people were still weird. They had terrible accents too. They called war wire. You know, tires. Now, you know, tars, they called them tires. And I thought they just didn't know what, they were pretty ignorant people. I didn't realize that I was the one who was ignorant. But on the ride over there, she told me all about Azusa Street and a man by the name of Seymour. Now, I'd heard of Azusa Street from my mother and from what we called a healing evangelist. And that old Pentecostal holiness preacher would mention it once in a while. So I heard of it. When I got there, Sister Goldie introduced me to quite a few of them. Later on, Harold Smith, the overseer, the pastor. Back then, we didn't call you guys pastor. We called you brother or sister. We didn't have titles, just brother and sister. Not very many sisters, mainly brothers. But they wanted to tell me the stories. Now, these people had people would come from all over the world wanting these people to tell them their stories. No, God will show us the one. I'm talking to, now some of you may not who I'm talking to, know him. I'm talking about Demas Shakarian, the founder of the Full Gospel Businessmen. Tommy Hicks of Argentine fame, Harold Bredesen, head of the Dutch Reformed Church, David Duplessis, better known as Mr. Pentecost. I'm talking about Dennis Bennett over the charismatic movement. They all would try to get these people to know. Well, I got there and I was saved, and they knew I was the one, but they wouldn't start telling me their stories until I got the Holy Ghost. I didn't want the tongue thing. My mother had that tongue thing, and that was the Holy Ghost, and I did not like the Holy Ghost. He told on me all the time. I couldn't do anything. I could walk back in that house and my mother would turn around and tell me what I'd done. And nobody else knew but me and the Holy Ghost. I didn't want it. Well, so Laura and them were praying and she got an idea. She came over to me and said, Tommy, there's something I'd like for you to do for me if you think you're man enough. Now, to a 17-year-old teenager, that meant something, folks. I drew my chest back and I said, well, what is it? She said, I would like for you to read for me and give me some explanation of the 9th chapter of Revelations. And I want you to think on this. Do you want to live through this? Well, nothing to that. I got down. I could read. Not very good, but I could read. Well, I got down and I started reading it, and it scared the toolies out of me. All this stuff falling on you, these things stinging you, and you couldn't die. But now, there was a little catch in there, and I caught it. It wouldn't harm everybody had the name of God on their foreheads. I put that book down, and I went running to find Laura. I said, Laura, how do you get the name of God in your forehead? She said, as soon as you get that tongue thing. Well, I changed my attitude. I decided I wanted the tongue thing. And a couple days later, I got it. And it took them about a couple of weeks for that. And they came up and said, Brother Tommy, we're from Azusa Street. And I says, I've heard of that. This says, we know God has sent you here for us to tell you our stories. And boom, it lit up a light because I'm a storyteller. And I'm all game for that. We got it settled down and I go to each one of them's home or apartment once a month. And there was quite a few of them. And I'd sit at their feet out of respect. Now, they did say, Tommy, is there anything you'd like to eat or drink? I said, I do like chocolate chip cookies and cold milk. And all but two of them would have that waiting on me. Brother Langford found out I liked strawberry ice cream, and so did he. So we had milk and strawberry ice cream at his place. Brother Salazar, he didn't like either one, so we had hot coffee. And that man made the strongest coffee I've ever drank. But we had it once a month. Now, they started telling me about Seymour. I got infatuated with this man. Now, a lot of people ask me about my book, and they says, Tommy, you never mention what color these people they are. I said, they didn't say it and I didn't ask. Who cares? They were different multiracial. Azusa Street didn't have that problem. Seymour wouldn't allow it. Now Seymour was black, blind in one eye. I started listening to their stories. I was so shocked, and Leon Kennedy took me to dinner in Hollywood. Him and Tim Story has some DVDs out on Seymour, and the women of Azusa Street and the history of Azusa Street. And he was asking me questions, and he started asking me about the healing evangelist. And I says, "Why you ask about them?" He says, "Tommy, Hollywood's interested in these stories that you," he says, "you think you could write a book on what you saw at the healing evangelist?" And I smiled, and I says, "There's five of them. I could write a book on each one of them. Then I could write five more books on all the rest of them combined." But I said, "Leon, there's four of you that they call historians on Azusa Street." He says, "There were four." I says, "What do you mean?" He said, "There's now five, and you're the fifth one." I said, "Why do y'all like my book so well?" He said, "We all had all the facts, all the history. We knew about the Shekinah glory. We knew about the flames going up. We knew about the miracles, but we didn't have any testimonies of them because then people wouldn't tell them, but they've told them to you." And I couldn't put them stories in a book, and for 40 years, God wouldn't let me. God has his timing for everything. What we've got to do is learn when the time is for God to tell. Now, folks, they would tell me this substance called, they call it Shekinah glory. And I had a Jewish rabbi tell me what it meant. It means God tents here. That glory of God is so strong and powerful that it shows up physically. You can see it. It flowed about a foot high until Seymour would get up and tell Charles, tell Brother Sines to play a certain tune. Usually that tune was "The Comforter Has Come." And when he'd do that, start playing it, that glory would start swelling and growing. It'd fill the whole building and get on the outside. Now listen to me good. You don't have to believe this, but this is what happened. Too much testimony. A flame would shoot up out of the ceiling and go about 50 foot in the air and stop. And then about 50 foot from that, a ball of fire would appear in the sky, and a stream of fire would shoot down and go through the fire coming up. And that's when, I mean, supernatural miracles begin to happen. And later on, I'll get into some of those. That's when Seymour would work some of the most mind-boggling miracles you've ever seen. But when I got with these people, I would start them off with, "What's the greatest miracle that God worked through you at Azusa Street?" Now, Sister Carney was kind of the ringleader. No one appointed her that. She just seemed to consume it. It just filled in as the leader. She had a rule on wheelchairs. You don't pray for someone to get healed in a wheelchair till you first put up the flaps, so they'll have no problem jump up out of the wheelchair and taking off. And many said, they'd come up with, "Okay, now the Carney rule, put up them flaps." Now, Ralph Riggs wasn't but 11 years old at Azusa Street, but he had miracles galore. Seymour came down three times a day, 7 days a week, for 3.5 years. And he'd sit down, put a towel on his head, and stick a box on his head, and sit there. Some say, "Why?" He said, "God told him to." And he'd just sit there for about 10 minutes or over an hour. Then when he'd start taking that box off, everybody'd run and get in their seats. When he wasn't speaking, where's my water? Thank you. When he wasn't speaking, pretty good water. Sometimes other people would speak. If there's nobody speaking, people went around getting people healed. And first one I asked was Sister Carney. I says, tell me the greatest miracle you remember that God used you to perform at Azusa Street. And she said a woman came in with a cloth on her head. And it was all dirty and bloody. And the woman looked like she was in extreme pain. And she asked the woman, she says, can I do anything for you? And she said, told her what had happened. See, the night before, the woman had caught her husband with another woman. And the other woman and the wife got into a fight. And the other woman bit the woman's ear off. And she was in a heap of pain, guys. Sister Carter says she reached up, took that cloth and pulled it back and looked. She said, Tommy, it looked like a raw piece of meat just on the side of her head. So she said she put it down quickly. It was kind of sickening to look at. And she started praying for her. The woman got all excited. Says, oh, this, it's tingling. Something's happening. So she reached up, grabbed that rag, looked up again, and right in front of her, an ear appeared. We need more miracles like that.
Yes.
Now, Brother Anderson, I believed he was kind of kin to the kangaroos. When he walked, folks, he took long steps and a long distance off. It looked like he was jumping up and down when he walked. And at Azusa Street, if he wasn't praying for somebody, he'd go get up on a pew so he could look out and see others working miracles. Now, his greatest one he remembers was a woman named Diane. She had a tumor about half the size of a basketball hanging on the side of her face. And back then, they didn't have as much medical convenience as they do now. They were afraid to cut it off if she should die. Well, it got malignant. And they told her she was going to die. Now, she only lived about two blocks from the old mission. And guys, she's the first one to call the fire department when those flames started telling them that the place was on fire. Fire department went down. Matter of fact, it went down about a dozen times. But it got to where when they'd call and say, that old place is on fire, they say, no, it's not. They're calling it Shekinah glory. It's not real fire. Stop calling us. They wouldn't come anymore. And I got to meet Sister Diane. She lived in Highland Park, and she was quite well known in Los Angeles. In about 1916 or 17, God told her to start a soup kitchen on Skid Row. And she said, she told me this personally, because I got to meet her. She dug in her purse and got the only thing she had, which was a quarter. And she said, Brother, she said, God, all I've got is a quarter, and God told her, that's sufficient. So she went down and bought what vegetables she could at the farmer's market with a quarter. Now, when I met her in 1960, she was having 10 meals a day and feeding 5,000 at a time. The governor of California honored her. The head county commission had honored her. The mayor had honored her. She told me, she says, when they told her that tumor was malignant and she was dying. She says, Tommy, I had three kids. I put one on one side, one in my right hand, and my tumor in my left hand, and I waddled myself down to Azusa Street. She said, when she came in, Tommy Anderson saw her come in because it was up on the pew. Well, he leaped down and ran over and said, now, after about 1907, they quit saying, we believe God will heal you. When they came up to you after enough, they said, God is going to heal you. They had gotten a lot of confidence. Now, Tommy ran up to it. His name was Tommy Anderson. There were four Tommies around Pisgah. You wanted Tommy, you always said the last name too, because if you didn't, four of us would come. Now, he ran over and said, God is going to heal you today, tonight. She said, Tommy, I wowed my eyes back in my head, and I says, that's what I came here for. Because she thought, go down to that mission. If you die, so what? You're going to die here. So go see what God may do. Because she had heard that miracles were happening down there. They started praying for it. She says, Tommy, I could feel that thing just getting smaller and smaller in my hand. Till all of a sudden, there was nothing there. Now, my favorite stories are two. One, Lucille with the teeth. Of course, Brother Langford also had a great one. All of them did. But see, I get so excited, then I go to tell them and I don't want to quit. Lucille was 4'10". She claimed to weigh 90 pounds. I believe she's lying. I believe she weighed more like 70. She had little bony fingers. Now, she liked to pray for teeth. Lucille didn't want to pray for all the mouth. She brought little hankies with her to clean the inside of her mouth out in case there was some bad stuff in there. She wanted to put her little bony finger on each place where a tooth should be and command a tooth to come in and push and let that new tooth push her finger up. She'd go around to all the teeth. She loved the ones that had no teeth. But now she had one person that she told me about. A woman and her husband had gotten into an argument, and the husband had decided to teach the wife a lesson. And he got a mallet and he crushed her wrist. Now back in 1906, the husband could, you know, be a jerk and get away with that. Thank God they can't now. And the woman, she couldn't move it. She had to work, do her housework with one arm. And it broke Lucille's heart. So she actually begged God to heal this woman. And she said, Tommy, I'm looking at her and I'm hearing popping in her arms, twisted. It is just like a puzzle, popping back in line and order. And before it was through, it was all healed. Now, guys, listen to me. About 2 months later, God saved the jerk. God will save a jerk. He became one of the leading ministers, Pentecostal ministers, in the Los Angeles and Southern California area. So don't judge too hard, okay? I still had to hurt. Oh. Now, Brother Langford, he's the what we call the Topeka, Kansas connection. He went to Topeka in 1903. He heard about this phenomena down in Kansas at this Bible school. Charles Parham had it. Now, he went there as a student in 1903, and in 1904 he came back for summer break. And he got with Dr. Yoakum of Pisgah and told him about, and he accepted this. And then him and Yoakum introduced it to the church, and the church accepted it. And a young 15-year-old girl there received it. Her name was Carney. She went and introduced it to her friends in Pasadena from the First Baptist Church. And they received it. And then they got the left foot of fellowship. And a man by the name of Frank Barlowman talked her into building a cell group, or he called them prayer groups. For over 2 years, he had 26 prayer groups all over L.A. praying for this revival. Now, Brother Langford, a man came in with his fingers cut off and a job accident, and it was getting pretty sore. And Langford, this is about 1908, he said, well, why don't we just ask God to grow him back? And the man said, what? He says, God will grow them back. You see this stuff floating around here? He said, God do anything in this stuff. God doesn't have to have the Shekinah glory to do anything, folks. But when his presence that strong, it's a lot easier to get faith. Amen. Now, he started praying for him and his little fiance at the time, which was Sister Langford now, when I'm talking to him, was helping hold a man's hand up. She said them fingers started growing up and she got overcome and emotional and she passed out. Now, Brother Langford had a big ministry of what you call cliff lips or hair lips, what we call them. Great, hundreds of miracles with these people. I'll tell a few more stories. Brother Fox was 51 years of missionary in India. Brother Fox had a whole school of the deaf came in. And they had kept telling their instructor that was teaching them signing, they wanted to go to Azusa Street. Finally, he took them, 35 of them. They got them down there, and he's trying to get them to get into a circle and hold hands. Of course, it took him quite a while because they didn't understand what he was saying. And the instructors over there kind of laughing at him. Oh, brother, Fox said, that's all right. And in just a little bit, you're going to be out of a job. He finally got him in the circle and he laid hands on one person and prayed. All of a sudden, that person started yelling because he couldn't hardly understand him because he couldn't talk plain. He told her and he was healed. And one by one, it went around the circle. All 35 got healed. The instructor wasn't laughing anymore. Now, the favorite story of all is the story of the staff. Sister Laura Langtroth. Now, this woman had a staff she used to put in front of her. She had lung cancer, which she was dying of. She stood 5'6" and weighed 65 pounds. Doctor says she should have died 6 months before. She would stick that staff out in front of her and scoot up to it. Stick it out again. Well, she decided, well, what do you got to lose? She had a doctor's appointment the next day, but they had told her she was dying. So she took several hours to scoot. She lived 2 miles from Azusa Street, down to Azusa Street. And she came in, she looked around, and hers and Laura Langtroth, Sister Laura's eyes met. And she said, that's the woman I want to pray for me. Sister Laura came over and said, Mother, what, you got to remember, she's 55 years old, and Laura's a teenager. Mother, what are you wanting? She says, if I don't get healed tonight, I'll die. So Laura prayed for her. She got miraculously healed. And she stood around in that glory for about 3 hours. She went home. The next day went to her appointment. But when she got home, she weighed again. See, she weighed 65 pounds. She got home that evening, she weighed 105. She went down to the doctor, whose name was Wyatt. It was only a block away from Azusa Street. They were trying to make her fill out paperwork for a new employee. They didn't recognize her. And she finally got them convinced who she was. So Dr. Wyatt got her in there and says, listen, there's no way you could have gained that much weight since the last time I saw you. She said, I know, but God, he says, you've been going down to that warehouse, haven't you? See, Dr. Wyatt was losing his business. He was just a block from Azusa Street, and all of his patients were going to Azusa Street and getting healed. Now, later on, Wyatt came to Azusa, slipped in, and had a worldwide ministry, healing ministry. It was called Wings of Healing. I would really have liked to have met him, but I was infatuated with Seymour. And I'd get some up and tell me how he didn't you see with Seymour. There are two outstanding ones that I know of. In 1907, a man had worked for the railroads and he had gotten his leg cut, caught, you know, and pinned, and they had to amputate his leg. Well, a stub that went down in that wooden leg had gotten gangrene, and the man was hurting. He's telling Seymour, and he says, okay, so some of you guys come up here and hold him. One of you take that leg off. And he was wearing overalls, so his legs were loose. Well, they took it off. Brother Sines, the one that told me the story, he said he laid hands on him and started praying for him. He says, is there something popping in that leg? All of a sudden, a foot shot out. God grew his leg back. Seymour did not preach that night. That man wouldn't shut up until after 2 a.m. I don't think I would either. How many of you have ever seen Sid Roth? It is supernatural. I've been on there twice. He showed these two of Seymour's miracles. About a year later, you had a man in there with 10 years prior had the whole shoulder here ripped off at a job related incident. And it was really getting bad. He's dying of it. It didn't have workman's comp back then, guys, and they didn't have disability. You go to a poorhouse. Well, he had one arm, so they let him, he could do minimal work, but he was put back to the lowest pay. Now, he had a dummy's arm hanging down there to try to look, but Seymour says, well, we got to take this off. It's going to be painful for God to grow this arm back. So they took it off, and he told the man, he says, now, if God grows your arm back and you get your good job back, you start paying tithes? The man kind of looks, yeah. He says, started laughing. He says, no, I'm just kidding with you. He says, that's between you and God. But Brother Salazar said he was looking down there and could see that bone. Terrible looking stuff, rotting. And he said he could look right down in the hole in his shoulder and see it. He said, Seymour laid his hand on his shoulder and started praying. And the bone started growing out. And about 4 inches behind it, the flesh would appear around the bone. And it went on out. And he said, Tommy, I even seen the fingernails come on. Wow. Seymour didn't preach that night either. Now, God plans it all out. The revival did not break loose at Azusa Street. It broke loose at a house on Bonnieberry Street. Seymour had been invited out to California to preach in the pastor church. He got there and that Sunday morning, he preached. He went back that Sunday night to preach again, and there was a padlock on the door with a note on it that told him he was fired. Well, a man walked up by the name of Ashbury. Now, Mr. Ashbury was one of Frank Barlowman's prayer groups. He said, William, I knew this was going to do this. He said, I've got a house over on Bonnie Bray. Come over there and preach from there. Well, Seymour didn't have much of a choice, so he agreed to. Of course, after the power of God fell there, he got the baptism there. Jenny Moore got it. When she got it, she got up and went over to an upright piano, never had a music lesson in her life, sat down and started singing a certain song and singing over 8 times, and each time in a distinct different language. Yes. But the power of God was falling so strong at Bonnie Bray that a block away there was a big street there called Beverly Boulevard. Well, innocent people will walk across that big street and they just fall out on the ground, on the street, speaking in tongues. And the horses would not step across the bodies. So it was causing a traffic jam. And the authorities had come down and told him, Seymour, your neighbors are complaining and calling because the yards were filling up around there because the house wouldn't hold it. The porch fell in. But he said, you're going to have to get you a building large enough to take the people or shut it down or we'll shut you down. So Seymour went to the Lord and said, you heard what the threats are making, Lord. He said, now I've been seeing an old building over on, an old warehouse over on Azusa Street. But God, I don't have the money. God told Seymour, after the service tonight, go to Pasadena and I'll show you where to get off. He said, all right, Lord, but you know there's a sundown law in Pasadena. Now, if some of you don't know what a sundown law is, if you're any color other than white and you were caught there after sundown, they arrested you. That means any, you know, American Indian, Mexican, Black, Oriental, and also Jewish, they'd arrest you. He said, but your word, I'll go. Well, he went. When he got on Colorado Boulevard. Now, if y'all don't know Pasadena and Colorado Boulevard, that's where the huge mansions are. Everybody on that street are wealthy. Well, Sister Carney's little group that she had got going from First Baptist, that's where they were. And that's where her prayer group was. And they were there praying. There were 15 of them, 12 women and 3 men. Of course, one of the women was Sister Carney. Well, he went up to the door and knocked. Well, Sister Carney went with the lady to the door. Who in the world would be knocking on your door at 10:30 at night? They opened the door, and here's standing this black man standing there looking at them that really should have been arrested, you know. And that woman said, can I help you? He looked at him and says, you're praying for revival, right? They said, yes. He said, I'm the man God has sent to preach that revival. Well, they invited him in. They chit-chatted a little bit. He preached. They took up an offering, which was well more than what he needed. Remember, all those people were rich people. They had the money. So Seymour went back and rented the warehouse. He got the people from Bonnie Bray and the people from Pasadena and brought them together. Now see, at Bonnie Bray, there was only one white dude there, and that was Frank Barlowman. All the rest of them were blacks, Hispanics, American Indians, Orientals, and that's it. But they brought the whites from Pasadena, and that's when Azusa Street became the first integrated church in America. Amen. Too bad it didn't stay that way, huh? Now, Seymour got up in November of 1909, just before the ending of the revival. Now, it went on until 1933, but the Shekinah glory and stuff left. He prophesied that in about 100 years, now not exactly, but in about, there would be another revival return like Azusa Street. Only this time it would not be in one place or with one person. It would be all over the world, and it would be with everybody in the congregation. Guys, the pastors can't do it all. They need what we call helps. Every one of you believers can get people healed. You can have miracles. All of you. It said, these signs shall follow those who believe. And I tell pastors, the only strong doctrine you got to worry about me teaching is they shall heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils, and speak with another tongue. Amen. That's what the Word says. Amen. A lot of people say, I've shocked people by saying, they'll tell me, did you agree with everything Wigglesworth said? I said, no. Said, you didn't? What did you agree? I said, Wigglesworth said, if the Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it. I said, don't agree with that. And my pastor, Neil Reno, says, you don't agree with that? He said, what do you think it should be? I says, if the Bible says it, that settles it. Amen. Whether you believe it or not. Amen. But listen, I'm going to believe it. If the Word says it, I'm going to believe it. Abraham was not counted unto him for righteousness for his faith. Now, I'm a strong faith person. I knew Kenneth Hagin Sr. I know Ken Jr. I believe in the faith message. But what was it counted to Abraham is righteousness. He believed God. That's all, believe. If God said it, that settles it. Believe it. Get out of here. Now, as those people would tell me their stories, well, just before I'd leave, they'd lay their hand on my shoulder, say a few seconds silent prayer. I finally got the nerve to ask Brother Sines, what are y'all doing? You lay your hand on my shoulder like that. He said, we're imputing all the anointings that we have off onto you. I said, oh, okay. Of course, I couldn't wait to get back to my little portion of the men's dormitory and get out a book I had from a man named Webster and find out what in the world impugnant. Well, it just means to transfer over. And I'm thinking, wow. Now, later on, I asked my mother why she dragged me or drugged me to all those heathen evangelists when I was a kid. I'm the oldest of 11. She didn't drag any of the rest of them. So she told me, I got her off alone. She says, when I was pregnant with you, I went to church with your Grandma Welchel, that's my father's mother, at a Pentecostal meeting, I went to the altar and got the Holy Ghost. Okay. She said, when I was sitting there resting after I was worn out from speaking in tongues, she said, God told me that child in you is a male child. And he will be a preacher man someday. Some say, God doesn't talk like that. I said, if you talk like that, God will talk like that. God talks your language. I know he talks mine, and sometimes he gets rough about it. Sometimes he has to. You know, I used to believe a woman could speak in church. And this would have been about 20-something, about 23 years ago or four. I got into Faith Family Church where I wrote the first book of them. They taught me how to run the sound booth. In case Scotty wasn't there, they taught about four of us. Well, Scotty wasn't there, so they got me to run the sound booth. My wife had already warned them, if you put a woman up there, Tom will get up and walk out. He won't sit there and listen. She said, he can come in the house and Marilyn Hickey can be on, or Gloria Copeland just walk on through. Well, I'll sit down and listen. It's a spirit, guys. Well, he said, folks, Samantha has the message tonight. And I said, what? He's going to let a woman speak. I started looking for the exit, and I thought, well, but you can't leave. You're running the sound booth. And inside me, a voice yelled, you shut up. I froze, and I looked around to see if anybody else heard it. They hadn't. But God was yelling at me, so I knew it's God. So I froze, and I listened. He said, she is under the anointing. And when she is under the anointing, it is her spirit speaking, and her spirit is neither male nor female. And gosh, I just said, oh, so that's it. I haven't had a problem since. It's a good thing. See, because it was a woman that got my book started in a big way. Her name was Billy Brim. And later on, what do you think most of the people that support me now today? Women preachers. See, God knows what he's doing. But sometimes he's got to get a hold of some old stubborn thing like me and yell at me. I'm glad it's just yelling. I got to see my angel a few times. He's about twice my size. And I don't want him kicking my rear end. He's threatened to. Now, I've seen Jesus twice. The last time, I wheeled around, stuck my face in his belly, and got a hold on him. And I wasn't going to let go. The first time I saw him, I passed out. I got overwhelmed. Hey, come on, I'm 17 years old. Here's Jesus walking up the aisles. This time he had a purple robe on. That was the most, oh, that was gorgeous. He gets up and I'm looking him right in the eye and I'm spellbound with the eyes. He got so close, he was touching certain people. He got almost close enough to me and I passed out and I fell past him. I asked Smith the next day, what did Jesus do? Said he looked down at you, kind of smiled and turned and walked on. Well, what else was he gonna do? Well, that bothered me. Adam, he was coming to touch me for 2.5 years. And then finally, that little story of Jesus walking down the aisles was getting around lost Southern California. And a man by the name of David Duplessis was there at a fellowship day and wanted Brother Smith to tell him a story. And then he says, now, Tommy Welchel over there, he really has a problem with, you know, passing out. And David, okay. Well, a little while later, he said, tell Tommy to come here. I've got a word from the Lord for me. Now, if you don't know David Duplessis, he was a major prophet of his time. He was known as Mr. Pentecost. I came over and sat down. He said, Tommy, do you have a clock, a time clock watch? I said, do you mean a watch with a clock with a timer on it? Now, he's from South Africa. They talk funny. He said, okay. He said, now this is a one-time thing and it's only for you. What? He says, you want another encounter with Jesus? I said, yeah. He said, this is what you do. You get that clock with a timer on it. Get in a hiding place, and I'm sure you have some around here. The grounds of Pisgah were large. And I had about a dozen hiding places around there. If I didn't want to be bothered, I'd go hide, take a nap. Well, my favorite one was up in the loft of Pisgah. Back in the back, I'd rearrange this furniture. It made me a little hiding place in the car, a little room. There were no electricity wires or anything up in the loft. So I went up there and I had a key to the church. It wouldn't have mattered back then if I didn't. I couldn't, never met a lock I couldn't pick. Now I can't pick any of them. But that's all right, I don't need to. I got my big flashlight, my little alarm clock, went up back there in the back. Set my alarm for 2 hours. That's what he told me. Set it for 2 hours. He said, you're going to pray, but you're not going to pray out loud like you always do. You're going to whisper, and you're going to whisper one word. I said, what's that? He said, Jesus. I set my alarm clock. I'm going to stand up a little bit if you don't want to run. My legs are getting a little numb, and I don't want to fall off this thing here. Now, I'm standing there looking and I went up there and I set it and turned my flashlight off and I'm starting to whisper Jesus. I thought 5 or 6 minutes. All of a sudden that alarm's going off. And I looked up, oh, My land, it's 2 o'clock. I up there and turned the alarm off. Then I froze. I looked down at the flashlight. It's off. But it's like daylight in there. I thought, Jesus, I look down here, nothing, look here. And he had on the most beautiful sandals. I didn't know he had some jewels in his sandals. I could see the holes, parts of the holes in his feet. And I looked at his hands. The holes were not there, folks. The holes were about right in here. I don't know why. I won't argue about it. But he had on the, this time it wasn't a purple robe. It was so bright that my eyelids had hurt my eyes. Ladies, that was gorgeous material. And I looked up at him. He looked down at me and smiled. And I wheeled around and threw my arms around him, got him in a bear hug and stuck my face right in his stomach. Then I felt a hand stroking the back of my head. Then I heard him speak my name one time. He said, Tommy, be patient and be obedient. Then he kept repeating, be patient and be obedient, over and over and over. All of a sudden, it's daylight out there, and he's gone. I think he taught me to sleep. That's the only way he's going to get away. I wasn't going to let go. Now, I relive these experiences every day. But when I left Pisgah in 1966 and stayed 2 more years, for 40 years, I wanted to tell these stories. And every time I would start to tell one of them, I'd hear, Tommy, be patient and be obedient. And I couldn't tell them. Now, 40 years later was 2006 and the 100th anniversary of Azusa Street. All of a sudden, I could tell them. We got a hold of a publisher. He came over to the pastor's house. We sat down. Now, I didn't write the book. I sat and talked into a microphone, and they recorded them. I needed at least one face to sit and look at and tell the stories to. Guys, within 32 days, we had that book in print. So, God knows what he's doing. And he has it all timed out perfectly. Stop and think. Now, in 1966, they were having the 60th anniversary of Azusa Street. Full gospel businessmen was. They were having it at Angela's Temple. That's Amy Simple McPherson's church. They were going to bring 3 of the Azusa Street saints there and have them give their testimonies. And that was Sister Carney, Brother Anderson, and Brother Langford. And they brought them there. But Jean Darnell she took the place of Amy, came up and talking to me, and she said, I'd address some envelope for her. When she'd go somewhere to speak, Pisgah had a magazine there called, or like a little newspaper called the Herald of Hope, that had a very large mailing address, 250,000. She was going to a certain town, this time was going to go to Seattle, Washington. Well, Smith would come over and tell me, she'd bring Smith some envelopes. And I'd go into the mailing list and get Seattle out and all the towns surrounding it and address these envelopes. And she'd take them back to the temple and then put circulars in there and she'd mail them out to where she's going to go speak. Well, she had come over there, was talking to some of the people. She was talking to Sister Carney and Lucille. Lucille used to be she was Amy McPherson's secretary. And she became Jean's for about 6 years until Smith got there at Pisgah. She left her and came to Pisgah. Jean told me, she says, Tommy, come here. I've got a word from the Lord for you. Me and George Ordway was putting the envelopes in her trunk. And I came over there, and of course, George could hear it. My wife could look out the window and see it. She says, the Lord told me. She'd been talking to those, you know, Lucille and Sister Carney. And Sister Carney said, if you want to hear the stories of Azusa Street, go talk to Tommy Welchel over there in the Herald of Hope office. Said he can tell these stories better than we can. Well, she told me, she says, Tommy, God has shown me that one of these days, that in the future, you're going to put these stories that all these saints are telling you into a book. And I said, okay. Now, man, I put that in my heart strong, but I never have tried to help God perform a prophecy. God doesn't need any help. Don't get ahead of God. And that prophecy came to pass 40 years later in El Reno, Oklahoma. Now, I went to Seymour's grave. God told me to. I went there, and I'm looking down at the grave, and God said, lay down on the grave. Now, this was the middle of July. It was hot. I was sweaty. And that grave was dirty. And I didn't want to lay down on it. But God said the second time, loud, lay down on the grave. So I thought, well, you better lay down. So I just got down and I laid down face first on the dirt. And all of a sudden, little tingles of electricity come up out of the dirt, coming into my body, all up and down my body, complete length. I don't know how long, quite a while. All of a sudden it stopped. And then God said to me, now you have it. And I started laughing. I said, now I have it. And I heard a big, deep voice on one side and a little chirpy voice on the other said, me too. Kevin Richardson and Dana Roman had laid down one on each side of me. And they had received the same experience. Now, Kevin was in the Missionary Baptist till he got the baptism with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, which he preached hard against. But he was doing the dishes for his wife. And he's standing up and saying, you're not speaking English. What's going on? So finally he kept calling his his elders, deacons, until he got one of them's wife, and she said, we'll be right down there, Kevin, to be with you. She got her husband and went down there, and she's standing there laughing. Finally, he's looking at her, and she says, you know that speaking in tongues that you say is of the devil, and we know we shouldn't get around it? See, she had the baptism, see. She said, Kevin, that's what you're doing. You're speaking in tongues. So he got really earnest in it, and we wound up together. Dana was four square, and she had heard about me a long time ago as a little bitty girl, a crazy yogi at Pisgah. Now, I have those anointings. Now, some people don't believe you can receive the anointing that way. I told one, I said, it's all right then, you won't get it. But I said, what in the world do you think they were doing in the Bible with Paul and Silas when they were in Jerusalem? They laid hands on them, imparted gifts to them, and sent them out. And they did that with a lot of others. I says, that's impartation of the anointing. Now, that's mainly my ministry. I go tell stories, I take questions and answers, and I pray a prayer of impartation of the anointing. Yes, I will pray for the sick. Now, there is too many here for me to lay hands on all of you. I'm too old, can't stand up that long, or can't even sit there that long. Last night I wasn't going to pray for them last night until God said, yes, lay hands on them. And I no more heard God say, yes, lay hands on them, until this little peanut came up in front of me and knelt down. It was her. And I'm looking at her, and I wonder why she's up there now. I hadn't made no altar call. But I got tickled at one little blonde-headed girl. When I first came in the church, I looked at this little blonde-headed girl, I don't know, what, 6, 7 years old? And God says, she talks to angels. I said, oh, wow. When she came up here and looked at her, I smiled and says, you talk to angels, don't you? She said, yes, I do. I says, good, you keep talking to them. Don't you let nobody talk you out of it. If she'll stay true to God, you'll hear from her someday. Now, I'll take a few questions. I'm going to have to pray a prayer, what we call a corporate prayer of impartation. There's one time I was before 10,000 people. And I said, whoever wants the impartation anointing, come up. All 10,000 got up. And I'm standing there and I look up at Kevin. He's about 6'4". And I look down at little Diana and Kevin said, Brother Tommy, corporate prayer, corporate prayer. There's no way I could have prayed for all 10,000 of those one at a time. And that's what I'll have to do. Now listen, there's already testimonies right now of people receiving the anointing from a corporate prayer. God does it. He can do anything. See, I loved old Webb Ellis' song, my God can do anything but fail. Now, I know I've got Seymour's anointing. And I've got all them saints' anointing. When my mother got that, God told her son was going to be a preacher man someday. She said, I took you to all their meetings so you could get their anointings. And I said, oh, wow, okay. So you know, that appeased me. Now, does anyone have a question? And you may need someone with a microphone to go to them. Come on, folks, everybody has some questions.
Is it true that the fire is back again at Angelus Temple? I just heard that people have seen the fire coming out of the temple. Just recently, I heard this about a week ago.
I did not understand. You interpret.
She said that she heard that the fire was back at Angelus Temple in Los Angeles. Is that true? Have you heard that report? The fire of God?
The fire going up?
At Angelus Temple. She just said she heard that in the last few weeks that they were witnessing
you?
That. So.
When I hear people say I heard it, I'm shocked sometimes. I go to places, Pentecostal churches had never heard of Azusa Street. And then I'm thinking, I'm shocked. You've never heard of us. You're Pentecostal? And a lot of people have never heard of that fire going up, but it's starting to get around. They're starting to tell it. And, yes.
What was the greatest miracle God worked through you?
What was the greatest miracle that God worked through you? Can you give testimony of the greatest miracle that God's worked through you?
Oh, many times. I was telling the Lucille story once in Albany, New York. And I'm just talking away and I hear this, ooh, and is there a problem back there, sister? And the woman next door said, Brother Tommy, no, a tooth just came in. And I said, don't you leave this service until I get to see that tooth. That's the most whitest tooth I ever saw in my life. And they said it just grew in. And it wasn't gold or silver. It was enamel. Now, most people to get healed in my meetings, I don't lay hands on them. They just get healed while I'm talking. I'm not the healer. God is. So if you get healed, give the glory to God. If you don't and you're upset, get upset with God. If you're foolish enough. But hell, I've had lots of healings in my meetings. One of the biggest I saw was How many of you have heard of Bill Johnson of Redding, California? I was in Pasadena, I was in my place where I stayed, up Eagle Rock. Randy Clark was at that big Oriental church, very well known. Well, I know Randy real well. So I was going to go up there and say hi to Randy. And I got up there and I wanted to go in, but the young lady was telling me there was no more seats. I said, okay, fine. But I'm leaving in the morning to go back. At that time, back to Oklahoma. Because I'd go through Arizona, visit my wife a little bit, just take care of her mother. But I said, listen, I want what was I saying now? Do what?
Bill Johnson.
Johnson. Yeah, she went down and she said, well, who are you? I said, I'm Tommy Welchel. She said, wait just a minute. I'll go down and check with Randy. And she kept glancing back. She said, don't go anywhere, Mr. Welchel. I said, I won't. She came running back up. Yes, he wants to see you. I said, thank you. Went down there, and there was Bill Johnson and his wife standing there, and me and Randy hugged and talked for a minute, and he says, Tommy, this is Bill Johnson and his wife. I said, oh, yeah. He says, of Redding, California. He said, yes. I said, I've seen you on Trinity. He smiles, says, he would like an audience with you. I have to go up now to the platform. I said, okay. I said, I'm still like a little kid, you know. He says, wow, Bill Johnson wants to talk to me. Well, he said, Tommy, he says, I see you're wearing hearing aids. I said, yeah. He says, you ever had any deaf people healed in your meetings? I said, yeah. He said, but you're still wearing hearing aids. I says, okay, Bill, what is it? He says, we have people coming from all over the world to our church in Redding, and they get healed. We prayed dozens of times for my wife's back, and she doesn't get healed. But she says, God told her, she told me that she had heard that you were in the Southern California. Now, Redding's way up Northern California. She said, well, Randy's down there too, so I know Tommy will try to go see Randy. So let's go see Randy, and if Tommy comes and says, I believe if he prays for me, I'll be healed. I said, really? He said, yes, really. Now lay hands on him and pray for her. I said, where's the back hurting at? And she showed right in the small of her back down there by her, right above her hips. I didn't want to lay my hand down there. Bill Johnson says, the doctor feels down there. Now lay your hand on her back and pray for her. Yes, sir. So I laid my hands on her back and prayed for her. She got healed. Now, why God does that, I don't know. Don't ask me. All questions I don't know the answer to. Why God will do this. Smith Wigglesworth had the most healings than anybody. And right up till almost the last of his prayers, he was in agonizing pain. He never got healed of those kidney stones until right at the last. He was praying for people and just in agonizing pain. He couldn't answer that either. He didn't know. But I wouldn't care who it came from, but if I got healed, I'd be very glad. Southern California. I go up 210 and go to Eagle Rock and get in a certain motel that I stay in. I won't go and stay in one downtown L.A. There's who crazy down there? And I was there speaking, and when I got through speaking, I had an area cleared out, and people that needed prayer, I told them to come up here, sit down. Now, they got there sitting down, and I told the people, I said, now, if any one of you out there get a word from God to come down here and pray for one of these, get up and obey God and come down here and pray for them. We're sitting there for quite a while. Finally, this little girl gets up and walks down the aisle. She walks up to the guy with a cast on his leg. It was her youth pastor. He'd gotten hurt in a ball game. She laid hands on him, prayed for him, and he got all excited and got some men around there to help him break that cast off. Then he got up and started running around the church. So did other people with him, and I'm sitting there and I said, I want to talk to the towel girl. I kept getting louder and finally I yelled out, get me the towel girl! Well, they see, I was getting a little upset, so they went and got the towel girl. Now, if you know what a towel girl is, you ever seen a football game where some little gal's going ahead and the players towels? That's towel girl. That's what she was on the ball field. Well, they finally got her down there to me, and I caught her by the hands. I said, sweetheart, how old are you? She said, 13. I said, I want you to listen to me. Did you know you can do this anytime, anywhere? She got the puzzled look on her face, kind of wrinkled up her nose a little bit, said, anytime, anywhere? I said, yes. Well, she goes back to school. The next ball game, the quarterback gets hurt. They've got him on the gurney, fixing to carry him out. She walked up to him and told him, listen, I believe in divine healing. And I believe if I lay hands on you and pray for you, God will heal you. Would you like for me to lay my hands on you and pray for you? He got out a very painful yes. So laid hands on him and prayed for him, and he got instantly healed. Got off the gurney and went back into the game. A little while later, the linebacker got hurt. Same thing. She prayed for him. He got healed. Went back in the game. It got to where when someone got hurt, the coach and the doctor were yelling, get the towel girl, get the towel girl. Guys, the last two games of the season, the opposing team was saying, send us your towel girl. The nurse in sick bay would call, if someone would come down sick in sick bay, and the nurse would get the girl out of class, come down there and pray for her. Now, they brought her before the school board, and they did it illegally because they didn't bring her parents with her. They were going to try to intimidate her. They were going to try to intimidate her to stop doing this. Separation of church and state, you know. She started smiling. She walked up. She says, good. My father says you were a very wealthy school board. The whole school district is rich because he wants to sue you for everything you've got. She said, I've never prayed for anybody that I didn't ask them that they want me to. And I have a constitutional right of freedom of religion. She says, my dad's already got a co-lawyer to help him. She says, have you ever heard of a man named Jay Sigalow? She says, you need to check him out because every time he takes this to the Supreme Court, he wins. She said, you're going to make Daddy so happy. Oh, it's going to be wonderful to see Daddy so happy around the house because he wants to sue you bad. She turned and walked away. She got to the door. She turned back and said, oh, by the way, don't forget to check out the man Sigalow. Turned and walked away. 2 days later, they brought her back down to the board. Said, all right, now listen, we've talked this over now. Listen, you can't just do it. You have to ask it. I told you that everybody I pray for, I ask. She said, if they say no, I won't pray for them. She said, but you're disappointing. Daddy was so happy. He wants to sue you so bad. Now, when that girl left that school, over 90% of them were Christian. She went to junior high. She had the same results. She went on through high school. She had the same results. She's now just entered this year. Oh, no, she'll be entering this fall. No. She's got a few months in college. She's having the same results in college. Just because Some old preacher told her, you can do this anytime, anywhere. And she was only 13 years old. You want revival? Get the four signs following and you'll have revival. Now, it was prophesied by those three. Seymour, Parham, and Eder. Guys, it's starting to break loose all over the country.
Amen.
Now, I know I'm telling the stories and I'm having fun doing it. I don't know exactly what parts I'm having. And Billy Brim says, I'm kind of like a forerunner. I said, oh, really? Wow. I said, now, Billy, don't you tell them I'm John the Baptist. She said, no, you're not. You're Tommy Welchel. I said, okay. But when she had me down at Prayer Mountain and I spoke to them last year, and then she brought me up to the prayer conference, and she and I on that Wednesday afternoon sat in two big chairs side by side talking. We got all kinds of guys of calls in with people getting healed, just sitting there watching us talk. I like it better that way. Then nobody can claim that they did it. Because, see, I'm not the healer. Neither is Billy. God is. It depends on if you believe you'll get healed or not. See, you can't get healed. The Word says, you were healed 2,000 years ago when he took the stripes. That healed you. You're just now waiting to try to get either the faith or to believe that you are healed. God's supernatural. He is a supernatural God.
Amen.
He doesn't do things the way we think he should do it. He really doesn't. Now, Ralph Riggs told me in 1960 that half of the Assemblies of God was backslidden. And I said, what? He said, you heard me. He said, half of them can't have revival. God won't let it. They won't let God in there. I said, you're talking about the Assemblies of God. He says, well, all the others the same way. They got the doors shut and their little articles of faith are keeping God out. And if the leaders of the faith are not, God's not moving to them, well, he can't move because they're the ones he's got to move through. No, he doesn't move through anybody.
Amen.
He doesn't have to move through me. He moved through anybody. It's according to your faith, and do you believe he'll do it? Now, some have problems. I don't know. I believe God healed my ears. You want the manifestation? I don't know. And there's been some saying, Brother Tommy, you need to get this. I said, then you lay your hands on my ears. You pray the prayer of faith and you get me healed. If not, I would like you to please be quiet. They lay hands on me. I'm not worried about it. The ones that are healed, I'm thrilled about it. Now, I've taken a lot of time telling more stories, so we need to quit the question and answer. What time is it now? Oh, my lands, it's 11:30 almost. I'm back on Oklahoma time, folks. Listen, I'm back in Oklahoma right now being a snowbird. My wife's back there trying to clean up that house and get it up to where we can sell it. My residence now is not too far from here. It's a place called Sun City. Now, I've been there since December 4th, 2010. Some say, well, why aren't you? I said, for 2 years, I couldn't do anything. I had a major heart attack in 2010. Guys, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be dead. And I told God, when the doctors told me they did not expect me to live, my daughter got upset with me because I smiled real big. I said, really? Okay. Because I've been to heaven 3 times, guys. You're going to like heaven. I was so thrilled. I would have been all right with me if I'd have never come back. When that doctor said I thought, wow, I get to go again, and this time I'll stay. I was thrilled. The kind of heart attack I had, only 4 of them like that had happened at Oklahoma Baptist Hospital, and they died. Both of my arteries going in, right and left artery, stopped. Both of the arteries going out stopped. I kept going, but I was feeling it, believe me, bad. But they went in there and took care of it. And I was in a coma for 2 weeks. Billy Graham was on the radio and the internet asking people to pray for me. People came by to see me. They couldn't talk to me. I was out, cold. But see, when that doctor told me that, I bowed my head and said, Lord, I wouldn't mind going on home, but not my will, but yours be done. If you have something else for me to do, then I'm in your hands. I'm not supposed to be here, but I am. So evidently God's got something more for me to do. And now there's churches. One is in Round Rock, Texas, a big Mexican church. I prayed a prayer for corporation prayer, you know, and guys, they're having revival down there now. And that's the first place I ever heard a song, Shekinah Glory Fall. I'd never heard it before. I don't know where the world they got that from. But I liked it. And I said, did y'all sing that for me? He said, but Tommy, we sing that every service. I said, wow, that's kind of neat. Now, Sid Roth had me to pray it for all the television land. And see, he said already he's gotten several hundred calls where people saying they've received the anointing. Now, I can't give it to you, but I can pray a prayer of faith of an impartation of that anointings that I have off onto you. Now, there's some people to say, I don't believe in that. Okay, then don't get it. But there's a lot of us that do. And those that do, I want all the anointings I can get, folks. When I get up around old Kenneth Copeland, I put my hand on his shoulder once in a while. I want the anointing he's got. Glory to you. I want the anointing that Billy Brim's got. All these people I get to meet. I never wonder, why in the world, God, you let me meet these wonderful people? Well, I don't know, but God's got his reasons. They say, well, you don't think you got enough anointing? Nobody has enough anointing. You can always get more. There's something you can pick out on and not worry about it. You won't take any from anybody. You just get what they got. They keep what they got. And you just got more. They just got more. Glory. Are y'all ready to receive the anointing? Okay, you'll need to stand up and put your hands out towards me.
Can I give you some water?
Let me, Heavenly Father, we come to you in the holy name of Jesus. I'm asking that right now, God, these people by faith are raising their hands to receive an impartation of the anointings that I receive. All the anointings I received from the saints of Azusa Street. All the anointing that I received when I laid on Seymour's grave. I'm asking now that you impart it to them in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah. Yes.
Yes. Now you start feeling something weird, that's the anointing. The anointing is not normal. It doesn't operate normal. Glory. Now, sister, you got my number. When people start turning in testimonies, mainly call to let Michelle Griffith know. She's writing more books, folks. This book is doing real well. People are receiving the anointing from it. But nothing's like receiving it from the person themselves. Listen, I believe you received the anointing. God never gives you a gift for you. He gives you the gift so that you may minister to others. That's why us preachers need one another. And that's what it means by submitting to one another. I need other preachers to pray for me. And I pray for them. Glory. I hope you enjoyed this. And more than that, I believe many of you have received an anointing. You have to walk out in faith and start praying for people. How many of you have ever heard of George and Francis Hunter? Do you know the first person Francis prayed for died? She got mad. But her daughter and husband says, don't quit praying for people. She kept on praying for people. They had one of the greatest healing ministries around. They've gone on to be the Lord. Now their daughters continued it. So, don't stop. The word's still right. Keep laying hands on people and praying for them. And some will start getting healed. And then more and more will get healed. I never worry about whether somebody's going to heal or not, because I'm not the healer. God is. God's the healer, folks. Jesus bore the stripes, not me. But we have to do something, and that is believe. That we receive, because the word says you're already healed.